Good evening. I'm Amna Nawaz. Judy Woodruff is away. On the NewsHour tonight, the state of the pandemic. Infections tick up in the United States, and Pfizer seeks approval for its booster shot for children. We speak to the White House COVID response coordinator about the latest. Then, lockdown. Residents struggle to find food as the Chinese government orders Shanghai shuttered amid the city's highest number of coronavirus infections to date. And an arms race. Ukrainian and Russian forces build up their munitions ahead of an
conduct of the war has continued. The Biden administration has sort of expanded its willingness to do more. And you're seeing that in terms of the pace and scope of weapons deliveries in Ukraine.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Fidelity dedicated advisors are here to help you create a wealth plan. A plan with tax-sensitive investing strategies. Planning focused on tomorrow, while you focus on today. That's the planning effect from Fidelity.
CFO. Caregiver. Eclipse Chaser. A Raymond James financial advisor tailors advice to help you live your life. Life well planned.
The Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org. Carnegie Corporation of New York, supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at Carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
COVID-19 booster shots may soon be available for children ages 5 to 11. Pfizer said today that an extra dose of its kid-size vaccine has shown a strong immune response. The company said it plans to seek FDA authorization soon. We'll talk to the White House COVID response coordinator, Dr. Ashish Jha, after the news summary. Russia suffered a blow today in its war with Ukraine when the flagship of its naval fleet in the Black Sea exploded and sank. Ukraine said it hit the ship with missiles. The Russians said the fire was accidental. The guided missile cruiser Moskva had 500 sailors on board and most were evacuated. In Washington, the Pentagon assessed the ship's loss.
It's basically designed for air defense. That's what this ship is designed to do, not unlike our own cruisers. So it's going to have an impact on their capabilities, certainly in the near term. Whether it has an impact on their naval capabilities in the long term is just unclear right now.
We'll return to the war in Ukraine later in the program. A federal judge in New York ordered the suspect in Tuesday's subway shootings held without bail today. Frank James appeared in court in Brooklyn, but said little during the hearing. Prosecutors said he had terrified the entire city of New York. James is accused of shooting 10 people. The exact motive remains unclear. In the Middle East, Palestinians say Israeli troops shot and killed two Palestinians in the West Bank in a new wave of violence. It happened in the city of Jenin. Israeli officials said soldiers returned fire after Palestinians shot at them. At least 24 Palestinians and 14 Israelis have been killed since the Muslim holy month of Ramadan began. Officials in South Africa now say severe rain and flooding in recent days killed at least 340 people. Heavy rains and mudslides swept away roads and bridges, destroyed schools, and devastated entire neighborhoods around the eastern city of Durban. Hundreds of people were left homeless.
I got no way to go now. I got no house, I got no nothing. Yes, my family is there by my neighbors. We tried to give me the place to sleep last night. We never sleep last night.
The death toll is expected to rise as scores of people are still missing and more rainstorms are expected in the coming days. Back in this country, social media giant Twitter is mulling a takeover bid tonight by billionaire Elon Musk. The Tesla CEO has offered to buy the company and take it private in a deal valued at some $43 billion. Musk is already Twitter's largest shareholder. He says he wants to make its algorithm and coding openly available. Twitter's board met today to evaluate the offer. A former top aide to President Trump, Stephen Miller, answered questions today about the January 6th assault on the U.S. Capitol. He is the latest from Trump's inner circle to go before a House Select Committee. The panel's chair says Miller spread false information about alleged voter fraud in the 2020 election. The Republican National Committee, meanwhile, has withdrawn from the Commission on Presidential Debates. Today's vote was unanimous. RNC members charged that the nonprofit commission was biased. The change means GOP candidates will appear only in debates sanctioned by the RNC. The International Monetary Fund warned today that the war in Ukraine has worsened inflation and endangered the global recovery. The agency's head, Kristalina Georgieva, said already 143 countries have had their economic outlooks downgraded. She spoke in Washington.
In the past 7 weeks, the world has experienced a second major crisis, a war on top of a pandemic. The threat to our collective prosperity from a breakdown in global cooperation cannot be overstated.
Georgieva also said the war in Ukraine is disrupting grain prices and threatening widespread hunger in developing nations. A new White House initiative aims to make government services more easily available for all racial groups. More than 90 federal agencies offered action plans today. They include improved language access for non-native English speakers and more aid for low-income households to save on energy bills, among other things. And on Wall Street, tech stocks took a hit and led the market lower. The Dow Jones Industrial Average lost 113 points to close at 34,451. The NASDAQ fell 292 points, 2%. The S&P 500 slipped 54, 1%. Still to come, on the NewsHour, protests erupt in Michigan after a black man is killed by police during a traffic stop. Florida and Kentucky become the latest states to pass new laws restricting abortion access. Schools struggle to accommodate the religious needs of Muslim students during Ramadan, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
With the rise of the BA2 variant in some parts of the country, many questions remain about how to best navigate daily life and what precautions should or shouldn't be taken. To answer some of those questions for us, I'm joined by White House COVID response coordinator, Dr. Ashish Jha. Dr. Jha, welcome back to the NewsHour. Always good to see you, and thank you for braving those rains to stand out and talk to us tonight. We should note that cases have been ticking up, and the graph we're about to show people here, I know you cannot see, actually shows back from October of 2021 to today. We are nowhere near the Omicron peak, we should point out, but there are a number of new cases, 33,000 just reported yesterday. What is fueling that uptick? Is it the rolling back of some of the mask mandates?
Yes, Amna, thanks for having me back. I think the major issue driving these increases in cases is BA2. This subvariant is even more contagious than the original Omicron, and we saw it fuel case increases across Europe, in Israel, and elsewhere. And I think that is the major reason we're seeing it happening in the U.S. right now.
We also know that at-home testing is being used a lot more than it used to be, but often people don't report those results. Could these case counts actually be higher than we know?
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, I'm a huge fan of home tests, right? I think they're great, but that does lead to some undercounting. But there are other ways that we're monitoring what's going on, right? Looking at wastewater data, looking at hospitalizations. There are other metrics we can use so that we have a sense of how much infection there is in the community.
So let me ask you about masking, because there is some confusion around this the longer the pandemic goes on. You have said very clearly, as have many officials, masking is an important tool to prevent spread. But when you look at the CDC guidelines online, they only recommend masking in areas of what they call high community spread. So if you log on and you look at the map, the vast majority of the country is green. It is low community spread. For anyone who looks at that map and says, oh, this is fine, I'm in a safe area, I don't need to mask, what would you say?
Yeah, so first of all, I think from a historical basis, we are at low infection levels, right? Like, yes, it is true they've gone up, but it's still very, very low. And hospitalizations right now actually are at the lowest point in the pandemic. So I don't think that I think that, you know, choosing not to mask up right now is reasonable. Obviously, if you're in a high risk setting, obviously, if you're a high risk person, in those contexts, wearing a mask is always reasonable and people may make that decision. I think CDC is laying out a broad framework for how to think about it for the broader public.
Well, given all of that, then help us understand why the extension of the mask mandate on in transportation. If people are on planes and trains and buses and masking, but then take those masks off the minute they go out to restaurants or schools or stores, what's the impact it's actually having?
Yeah, so I think the CDC decision to wait 15 days to make a more durable decision on masking on planes and transportation is very reasonable, and here's why. BA2, the variant that we've been talking about, just became dominant over the last couple of weeks. Whether it's going to cause a larger increase and whether it's going to cause substantial increases in hospitalizations and deaths, we don't think so, but we don't know for sure. And what CDC scientists are saying is 15 more days would give us actually a lot more data on that, and that will allow us to make a more data-driven, informed decision. Feels really reasonable to me to make that to take that 15 days and make a better decision.
To be clear, you don't know for sure yet if BA2 could lead to more hospitalizations, but you think within the next couple of weeks you will know that?
We'll have a lot more information, yeah. So I think within the next couple of weeks, you know, once something becomes dominant, usually about a week or 10 days later, you start getting a pretty good sense of what's happening with hospitalization. Certainly by 2 weeks, I think we'll have a much clearer picture.
So let me ask you about vaccines then as well, because we reported earlier in the show, of course, Pfizer is seeking that approval for booster shots for younger kids. But they have authorized the second booster, which is effectively the fourth shot for people 50 and older and those who are immunocompromised. There seems to be some debate, even in the scientific community, about how necessary, how effective that fourth shot really is. So what do you say to that?
Yeah, the best data we have on the fourth shot is from Israel. And the data is actually, I think, quite clear. People over 60 who got a fourth shot had dramatic reductions, not just in infections, which of course matter, but in hospitalizations and deaths, which is the thing we care most about. So I feel like that based on the data, people over 60 who are 4 or 5 months out of their second shot, I mean, out of their third shot, should get that second booster. I think that second booster is going to be protective. 50 to 59, the data is less clear. If you're a higher risk, it makes a lot of sense to me. And I think they should, people 50 to 59 should consider it. But to me, 60 and over, if you're going to follow the Israeli data, it's clear people clearly benefit from that second booster.
So following the data with younger kids in particular, and following what we've seen across the country, there are very few younger children in America who are fully vaccinated in that age group 5 to 11. It's still about 28% of that population. They are back in school. Masks are coming off. We have not seen huge outbreaks. You yourself have said we don't have a reason to be excessively concerned. So what's the argument to make to parents that they should get their kids vaccinated in the first place, much less boosted?
Yeah, it's a great question. I have a 10-year-old, and I got him vaccinated the first day he was eligible. And the question is why, and it's really straightforward, right? Because we know these vaccines are exceedingly safe. And while infection numbers are low right now, they might rise again. They have been obviously higher in the past. And protecting our kids against it with a very, very safe vaccine, to me, is a no-brainer. And that's why I have been very strong proponent of getting kids 5 and above vaccinated, because the evidence is that the benefit is substantial and the risks are very, very small.
But to be clear, you are asking, or you're suggesting it, recommending it based on a potential future variant, because we haven't seen that uptick in hospitalization so far, correct?
Yeah, I am saying, first of all, that even when kids get infected, I mean, if you have a very safe, effective vaccine that prevents infection, kids should get vaccinated against that virus. And yes, it's true, we have not seen an uptick, but kids continue to get infected from this virus. Obviously, some proportion of them still do get hospitalized. And if you have something that's very safe and effective that can prevent that, I strongly recommend to parents that they get it.
So we know cases are going up. We know the virus is circulating. I can remember conversations between you and I with other experts over the last 2 years. You have said very clearly the more the virus moves, the more the potential, the greater the potential it could mutate, and we don't know what could happen next. So how worried are you about another potentially more dangerous variant?
Yeah, you know, we're 2 years into this pandemic. We have seen a new variant that has caused substantial disruptions about every 6 months. I remain worried about that, and the best way to prevent that obviously, is to get as many people vaccinated and boosted in the United States, but it's also to vaccinate people globally. I mean, there is no question about it that if we let this this virus run rampant across the world, it is just risking more variants, and those variants end up eventually coming back to the United States. So we really need a global strategy here, and we need to make sure we're vaccinating the entire world while continuing to focus on vaccinating Americans.
In just a few seconds we have left, you have a huge portfolio now in running the White House COVID response. What would you say at this point in the pandemic is the overall goal? Is it to try to actually prevent spread or just to keep people out of the hospital?
I think it's both. I think we should be doing things that are sensible, reasonable to keep infection numbers low, right? We should be encouraging people to get a test before they gather in large groups. We should encourage people, if you're going into a high-risk situation, you should think about it. If you have symptoms, you should stay home. And there's a lot we can do to reduce spread. That said, obviously we care about hospitalizations and deaths a lot, and that means getting people vaccinated, boosted, getting people therapies that are becoming widely available. I don't think we have to trade off between cases and severe disease. We can do both using different set of tools for different goals.
That is White House COVID response coordinator Dr. Ashish Jha joining us tonight from the White House. Thank you so much, Dr. Jha. Good to see you.
Thank you.
Today, Shanghai, China's largest city, reported 27,000 new COVID cases. That is the highest single-day total reported anywhere in China at any point during the pandemic. Much of the city's 25 million people have been under strict lockdown for 3 weeks. Guangzhou, with 15 million residents, is now closed to visitors. Nick Schifrin reports now on China's zero COVID policy that has pushed residents in Shanghai to frustration and anger.
In one of the world's richest cities, residents scream, "Give us food." Last week, they were so hungry they ransacked a grocery store. In this apartment complex, a woman screams, "We are starving to death." But police in hazmat suits enforce the rules by any means necessary. They take a woman who didn't want to test and separate her from her husband. Just yesterday, a man tried to hide on his balcony. No match for authorities imposing one of the world's strictest lockdowns. And after 3 weeks of containment, residents are willing to confront the communist state. The anger aimed both ways. A city worker had to be restrained from attacking a resident who criticized him. Today, as they do every day, residents lined up for mandatory tests, and some restrictions have been eased. But much of this metropolis is still locked in silence. Everywhere you turn, yellow barricades barricade apartment buildings. Other buildings' front doors are taped, warning residents against going in or out. This is home for an American who asked us to keep him anonymous.
Initially, it was, where can I buy an egg? And in the city of Shanghai, that's kind of crazy. Most of the day is occupied with trying to secure food and water supplies, other essentials. There's a lot of rising frustration. There's also a lot of young people who are willing to step up and help.
The way he's helping, organizing bulk food and water purchases designed to last a week. It's the only way to get around food shortages.
People just want their basic needs met, and they want, I think, basic respect.
Beijing has worked to improve the access to food, but it rejects calls to ease lockdowns or allow the country to live with COVID, which means residents still acutely fear getting sick from neighbors or being quarantined.
We had learned that the infected person had gone through that stairwell, and we said we can't go down. Like, we don't have, you know, contamination suits. At any time, you could be taken from your place and put indefinitely into one of these quarantine centers.
So this is basically how my room looks like. 138 is my number.
This is a quarantine center. People who test positive are forced to live here communally.
And now we're going to walk into the bathroom area.
This was an exhibition center. Now it's home to 4,000 people. This was filmed by Jane Polupko. She says she's the only foreigner.
The facilities are not great. We don't have shower here. So it's been like 18 days without shower. The lights that you see here in my background, they are on 24/7. They never turn them off.
Do you have any privacy?
No.
Over there, we have the main entrance where people come in inside.
Her past three tests have been negative, but she still has no idea when she can leave.
This uncertainty, lack of communication, that just adds up on the, you know, collective anxiety, basically, what people are having here. It's not only me who feels frustrated, angry, anxious. I really don't understand why we're forced to be here when we're actually not that dangerous for the society.
Beijing defends its zero COVID policy as saving lives. China claims only 13,000 COVID deaths, as Foreign Ministry spokesman Zhao Lijian argued on Tuesday.
China's dynamic zero COVID policy and anti-epidemic protocols are based on science and expert opinions. They have effectively protected the life and health of Chinese and foreign nationals living in China.
But it's also about political stability.
That policy in China, you cannot just justify that from a public health perspective.
Yan Zhang Huang is the Council on Foreign Relations' Senior Fellow for Global Health.
When the top leader himself is personally invested in that policy, right? That policy U-turn could undermine his personal leadership and even cause him problem for regime legitimacy.
Beijing's also worried about its healthcare system being overrun. But COVID restrictions limit Shanghai Hospital's ability to provide regular health care. And social media is full of videos of patients rejected care. Pleas to healthcare workers ignored. And a desperate family for whom health care was kept out of reach. Yesterday, a man yelled at visiting officials there wasn't enough to eat. He was later detained. The restrictions in rich, educated Shanghai threatened to create the very political instability that officials are trying to prevent, says University of Toronto professor Lynette Ong.
Once people start questioning that, they would show some sort of resistance, either overtly or covertly, and that in itself may actually evolve into another source of social unrest.
But authorities appear unmoved and continue heavy-handed tactics.
Any sort of positive cases or death rate means that the officials have failed to perform their duties. And that would look very bad on their career, which is why you see all sorts of, you know, measures, counterintuitive, sometimes to the extent of being silly, being taken.
For Polubko, that means it's time to leave China after 8 years, even if home is Ukraine. She's from a city in the middle of the war.
I only want to get out of here. I definitely cannot wait to go to Ukraine.
For her, a war zone seems better than COVID zero, with no end in sight. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin.
Another unarmed black man has been shot and killed by police, this time in Grand Rapids, Michigan. William Brangham has the latest on this case and the ongoing questions about police use of force.
26-year-old Patrick Leoya, a Congolese immigrant, was killed April 4th by a Grand Rapids police officer after Leoya tried to run from a traffic stop. There was a struggle, and as this cell phone video of the incident shows, the officer on top of Leoya pulls his gun and shoots him in the head. No other weapons were found at the scene. Last night, protests erupted in Grand Rapids after the release of this video. The officer has been put on paid leave pending an investigation. Today at a press conference, Leoya's father, Peter, described his emotions.
My life was Patrick, my son. I was thinking that Patrick will take my place. And to see that my son has been killed like an animal by this police officer. And to see this video they show. I see that I have no life. I see my heart being broken.
Naomba sheria.
I'm asking for justice.
And joining me now from Grand Rapids is Bryce Huffman. He's a reporter for the nonprofit news organization Bridge Detroit, and he's been covering the Grand Rapids area for years. Bryce, thank you very much for being here. We understand that this officer has been put on paid leave. Can you give us a little sense, what else is happening with this investigation right now?
Right now, the Michigan State Police are investigating the incident. They're investigating whether or not the officer did anything wrong. Obviously, people who have seen the video will come to their own conclusions on that. But right now, the Grand Rapids Police Department is really deferring a lot of the questions to the Michigan State Police as the investigation is still ongoing.
Can you tell us a little bit more about Patrick and the Congolese community that he lives in?
Yeah, so Grand Rapids has a nice little Congolese community of about 7,000 to 8,000 people. Most of them are refugees, so they came here fleeing violence in the Democratic Republic of Congo. And that's exactly why Leoya's family came here to Grand Rapids in 2014. There's not a whole lot that is known about his personal life at this point. We know that he has a few brothers and a sister. We know that his family is here and they're grieving. And we also know that now that he has passed, his family is preparing the funeral arrangements as we speak.
I understand you were at that press conference today. We heard a little bit from that father, who is obviously just in a stunned sense of grief. Do you have a sense from today what the family would like to see done? What are they asking for?
They're asking for a couple of things. Broadly, they want justice. They want the police officer's name to be released. They want to understand the history of the officer who took their son from them. And they also want the police department to be held accountable for that. At the press conference, there were lots of reporters there asking questions. One of the many things that a lot of us wanted to know is just what the family wants to see done with the police department going forward. And these are things that are kind of still in the early stages, but they do want to see the police department eventually change to a point where no one else has to lose their life like Patrick did.
I mean, you mentioned that the police have not been saying that much, but the video that we have all seen shows Leoya did struggle with the police officer and tried to get away, but there seems to be no evidence on the video that he was attacking the police officer in any way. What have the police said about this officer's actions?
So far, they really haven't said much about the actions. They say that it's regrettable. They say that it's a tragic incident, but they haven't come out and said that the officer did something undeniably wrong, but they also haven't tried to justify the officer's actions by saying, he was defending himself or others. What we do know from the video is that there was a bit of a struggle, and during that struggle, the officer's body-worn camera was turned off. The police chief here, Police Chief Winstrom, believes that it was turned off because it was just being pushed during the struggle. But we still don't really know a whole lot about the events that occurred off screen of the video. We don't really know yet if the officer will be charged with anything. A lot of these things are still just too early to say.
As I mentioned, you've been covering the Grand Rapids area for a very long time, and I understand that this is not the first time that the minority community there feels like the police have treated them badly.
Yeah, so in Grand Rapids in 2017, there was a traffic study done that found that Black motorists are twice as likely to get pulled over as white motorists, even though at the time, the black population was only about 14% of the city's population of around 200,000 residents. We also saw that in 2017, there were incidents where unarmed children were held at gunpoint by officers, handcuffed by officers, searched by officers, and these sorts of events where unarmed children were being mistreated by the police, they occurred multiple times in a row. And the police department, they had outside consulting firms come in to try to help them remediate that problem. But as obviously we can see by what happened to Patrick, those efforts were not enough.
And lastly, I understand that there's a protest going on there tonight. Can you give us a sense? Do you think that that's going to continue in the days ahead?
Yeah, as you said, there's a protest happening right now. I imagine much like in 2020 after George Floyd was killed in Minneapolis, there are going to be protests all throughout the weekend, most likely here in Grand Rapids, potentially well into next week or beyond, because this was an incident that happened right here in Grand Rapids. But like we saw in 2020, or I should say, unlike we saw in 2020, where some of those protests did get a little violent and there was property destruction, the protests so far have been really peaceful, and the Lioia family actually wants it to stay that way. They want their son to be remembered for being a peaceful person and not inspiring or inciting violence.
All right, Bryce Huffman, journalist with Bridge Detroit, thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
This week, the United States authorized one of its largest arms packages yet for Ukraine. The $800 million worth of weapons is designed to help Ukraine in what's expected to be a large upcoming battle in eastern Ukraine. The question of whether to arm Ukraine is one that has challenged American policymakers for years. Ali Rogan has a look back at how recent presidents have dealt with that question and what lessons the Biden administration learned from them.
As Ukraine's eastern Donbas region prepares for a renewed Russian offensive, the U.S. announced another transfer of weapons to Ukraine from its own reserves, this time including heavy weapons.
They will be facing Russian forces that are familiar with the territory in that part of Ukraine.
8 years ago, Russia first invaded eastern Ukraine, and the face of U.S. policy in Ukraine was Vice President Joe Biden. During the Obama administration, Biden made 6 visits to Ukraine. But before the invasion, he was focused on anti-corruption reform, democracy, and the so-called reset with Russia.
We're working, as you know, Mr. President, to reset our relationship with Russia. But I assure you and all the Ukrainian people that it will not come at Ukraine's expense.
But then in 2014, Putin invaded and annexed Crimea and started the brutal war in the Donbas. The U.S. imposed targeted sanctions, pushed for a diplomatic solution, and provided non-lethal aid, like helmets, first aid kits, and radars to the Ukrainians. But no lethal aid, like weapons and ammunition, despite President Petro Poroshenko's pleas to Congress.
Please understand me correctly. Blankets, night vision goggles are also important. But one cannot win the war with the blankets.
Alina Polyakova is the president and CEO of the Center for European Policy Analysis, a Washington-based think tank.
The Obama administration wasn't willing to go into the so-called lethal aid category because the fear was that there would be a provocation of Russia to do something even more escalatory in Ukraine.
The Pentagon did start training Ukrainian soldiers in 2015. In an exit interview with The Atlantic magazine, Mr. Obama said Ukraine, quote, is going to be vulnerable to military domination by Russia no matter what we do, and that there's always going to be some ambiguity on U.S. policy there.
It's an honor to be with you.
Donald Trump brought a different sort of ambiguity. While he embraced Putin, his administration armed Ukraine, selling Kyiv hundreds of Javelin anti-tank missiles in 2018. The next year, Ukraine was set to receive almost $400 million in military aid, including money for more weapons. But Trump blocked it, sparking the events that led to his first impeachment. In a July 2019 call, newly elected President Volodymyr Zelensky said Ukraine was, quote, almost ready to buy more javelins. Trump responded, I would like you to do us a favor, though, asking Zelensky to investigate his presumed presidential challenger Biden and his son Hunter, who'd had business in Ukraine. Trump and his aides defended the hold.
We do that all the time with foreign policy.
Top officials said that was not true, like William Taylor, who served as ambassador to Ukraine under the previous 3 presidents.
I and others sat in astonishment. In an instant, I realized that one of the key pillars of our strong support for Ukraine was threatened.
The hold was lifted in September 2019, and Ukraine received the funding. Alina Polyakova says policy-wise, Ukraine benefited from the Trump years.
The Trump administration signed off on these Javelin anti-tank systems that the Obama administration drew a red line on. And the response from Russia was really not a peep.
The considerable Washington fallout was mostly political. To defend Trump, his lieutenants and allies made Ukraine a scapegoat.
Would that money get to the right place, or would there be corruption in Ukraine and the money wouldn't flow to the mission that it was intended for?
Once he returned to the White House in the top job, Mr. Biden continued providing lethal aid, announcing a new $60 million package during Zelensky's first visit in September 2021, including more javelins.
Good to see you again.
As Russia's military massed on Ukraine's border, Biden tried diplomacy. He held a virtual summit with Putin in early December and reportedly delayed providing another $200 million worth of military aid until the end of the month. Dustin Walker is a defense expert with the American Enterprise Institute, a conservative policy organization.
What we saw in the run-up to the conflict in Ukraine is the Biden administration, I think, operating under the mistaken belief that military power and diplomacy came at the expense of one another.
A month before the invasion, Biden was highlighting the weapons already provided and predicting how he thought war in Ukraine would end.
I've already shipped over $600 million worth of sophisticated equipment, defensive equipment, to the Ukrainians. The cost of going into Ukraine in terms of physical loss of life for the Russians, they'll be able to prevail over time, but it's going to be heavy.
In early February, the U.S. deployed troops to fortify NATO's Eastern Front and impose sanctions in coordination with NATO and the EU. 2 days after the invasion began, Biden approved a third weapons tranche, this time $350 million worth, including more Javelins and Stinger anti-aircraft systems.
Got here, okay.
In total, Biden has provided almost $3 billion in security assistance since the war began.
Ukraine needs weapon supplies.
Just before Wednesday's announcement of new weapons, Zelensky released a video in English with specific requests. Some of the items, like artillery systems and armored personnel carriers, are now headed to Ukraine for the first time. Others, like jets, are not. Pentagon spokesman John Kirby acknowledged that the list isn't everything Ukraine wants.
Clearly, it's curated. I mean, but it very much reflects what they need, and it's a growth outgrowth of actual, no kidding, discussions that we've had with Ukraine.
The U.S. says the aid will get to Ukraine quickly. But Ukrainian officials say the decisions to send them are taking too long, as Foreign Minister Dmytro Kuleba told NewsHour special correspondent Simon Ostrovsky.
We get everything. But the time between the initial question that we asked and the moment when we get it is wasted.
Mr. Biden is mindful of that criticism, says Dustin Walker.
As the conduct of the war has continued, the Biden administration has sort of expanded its willingness to do more. You're seeing that in terms of the pace and scope of weapons deliveries in Ukraine.
Today's American policy towards Ukraine is much different than it was in 2014. Its effectiveness is getting tested every day of this war. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Allie Rogan.
State legislatures across the country continue to pass new restrictive abortion laws. Just today, Florida's governor signed a 15-week abortion ban into law. That comes right after Kentucky's new abortion bill was implemented, one that opponents say effectively shuts down all abortion access in the state. John Yang has more.
Kentucky's law took effect yesterday after the state's Republican-controlled legislature overrode Democratic Governor Andy Beshear's veto. Both the ACLU and Planned Parenthood immediately asked a federal judge to block the new law, saying it violates the current Supreme Court limits on what states may do about abortion. Shefali Luther is a health reporter for the 19th. That's the nonprofit online news organization that focuses on the intersection of gender, politics, and policy. Shefali, thanks so much for being with us. A lot of provisions in this bill. What are the most salient things in this bill? What is it? What exactly does it do?
So you're right. This bill is 60 pages. It is absolutely mammoth. And it's gotten headlines for its 15-week ban, for restrictions on medication abortion, for new requirements for minors who want to receive abortions. But arguably the most important thing it's done is it has imposed all of these new regulations on how abortion clinics operate, requiring them to publish the names of all of the medical providers who perform abortions, requiring them to register different processes with the state under programs that don't yet exist. The restrictions are so much under programs that aren't really enforceable yet that the clinics have no choice at this point but to stop performing abortions because they've no way to comply.
So the two outpatient abortion providers in Kentucky, you say they've had to stop? And what's this doing to women in Kentucky who want to terminate their pregnancies?
There are no clinic-based options for abortions at this point in Kentucky because you're right, there's Planned Parenthood and there's EMW. Hospitals perform some abortions, but it's a really tiny fraction. maybe a dozen out of more than 3,000 abortions done every year. So if you live in Kentucky at this point and you want an abortion, really your only option is to travel out of state. The next nearest places are Indiana, maybe Ohio, maybe Tennessee, but those can be long, expensive journeys, and an abortion is already a very expensive, inherently unplanned expense.
Already today, we saw not only this law go into effect, but in Florida, Governor DeSantis signed a 15-week ban on abortion. How do these things fit in as to what states are doing as we wait for the Supreme Court to hand down its abortion ruling before summer?
What we're seeing is, in particular, Republican leaders of states are trying a variety of approaches to try and restrict abortion as much as they think is feasible in their states. Governor DeSantis of Florida is particularly interesting because it seems that the appetite maybe isn't there for a total ban. They're trying to suggest that maybe a 15-week ban could be more palatable. A 15-week ban is what's being debated in front of the Supreme Court right now. What we'll note is that both sides have a lot of issues with even that as a restriction, right? A 15-week ban means if you have a fetal anomaly discovered later in pregnancy, or if you have lesser means, had to travel further to get an abortion, you may not make it in time.
And we should note that the Kentucky law has no exemptions whatsoever for rape or incest. You talk about the sort of the palatability of various cutoffs for these laws. What's been the reaction or the sense among the people in Kentucky during this debate, during the veto, during the override of the veto?
Yesterday it was such a powerful day, and you saw emotions running really high on both sides. The Republicans putting forth this bill, many of them really believe that it's important, and they were talking about it as if it could save lives, right? That's the argument they're making. And then you heard Democrats who talked, one started crying, telling the story of a woman she met who had a pregnancy that she couldn't carry to term, that the fetus didn't have a working heartbeat. And she spoke about the impact that it has had on cases like these where you know you need an abortion and you can't get one. There were protesters outside the legislature chanting bans off our bodies, and they were so loud that at least at one point, the lawmakers had to ask each other to speak louder to be heard.
And all these states sort of acting or trying to take action ahead of the Supreme Court. Tell us what, in Kentucky in particular, what happens if the Supreme Court, this law is in effect, or it's in effect for now, but if the Supreme Court were to end abortion rights, what happens then?
Kentucky, like so many states, has what's called a trigger law. And that law is written so that it would take effect if and when Roe v. Wade is overturned. It would essentially ban all abortions in the state. So we'd go from what's currently, right, a de facto absence of abortion to an actual complete ban on the procedure.
Shefali Lutheroth from the 19th, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
Well, this month marks the holy month of Ramadan, a time of fasting and prayer for Muslims around the world. But here in the United States, it can also bring challenges for students and parents trying to navigate both school and religious observance. NewsHour's Robbie Chavez has been reporting on this topic from New Orleans, and he joins me now. Robbie, it's good to see you. You've been talking to students and to parents there who are seeking some kind of accommodations from those schools. What exactly are they asking for, and what's the response they've been getting from school leaders?
Yeah, parents have been involved in an email campaign trying to get the Louisiana Department of Education to issue some sort of guidance for practicing Muslim students to have accommodations during Ramadan. Now, some of the things that they're looking for, they would like to have some private space for students when they might have 3 minutes of prayer or need to be away from other students when other students are eating. They want some flexibility in testing. They also would like some diversity training so that other students understand the cultural differences at the school. At this point, the Louisiana Department of Education and the superintendent, Cade Brumley, has refused to issue guidance to the state's schools, except to say that this is up to the districts on the district level. So that has left a lot of problems for parents, because what we end up seeing is that parents are having to ask for these accommodations at the classroom level. And so some parents may be getting those accommodations, others may not. So when you leave it up in the air without specific guidance and taking a leadership role, it leaves a patchwork of policy. And in many cases, students are not getting those accommodations.
So, Robbie, in places where those accommodations are not in place, what are you hearing from students and parents that the impact of that is?
Look, it's tough on the students. As you know, when you're fasting, you're not eating or drinking any water from the time that the sun comes up in the morning. That's particularly challenging for students in the classroom. And so it's very hard for them to concentrate. They can't participate in physical activities because they might get exhausted, particularly in the Louisiana heat. And on the bigger picture, it's taking an emotional toll because these students then have to balance their academics with their religion. And in some cases of the students and parents that we talk to, students are either hiding that they're fasting or just not participating in it at all. And now when compared to other faiths, it's been a struggle for Muslim students and their families to fight for holiday accommodations. In New York City, Muslim students make up about 10% of the public schools. Students there have had Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur off since the 60s, but two major Muslim holidays of Eid, they were just added in the last 6 years. And so you can see the slow progress here. And keep in mind, religion, by some statistics, shows is extremely important to young Muslim students. And 72% of Muslim parents send their kids to public schools.
So, Robbie, what about the rest of the country? I mean, what are some of the rules that are in place in other places that schools have to abide by to make those kinds of accommodations?
Well, we talked to the Council for American Islamic Relations, or CARE. They're one of the leading advocacy organizations that kind of tracks these issues for the Muslim community. What they tell us is that this is still a problem across the country, though the numbers of students going to public schools is very hard to track. It's very hard to know how many are getting accommodations as well. But what they do tell us, it's a problem, and they say it's a work in progress, and more work indeed needs to be done. What they also say is that what is happening here in Louisiana tracks what they see across the country. So in areas that you have larger Muslim populations, it's much easier for those public school students to get those accommodations. But in rural areas, much like Louisiana, where you don't have a large population, those accommodations are much tougher to get. And that's exactly what we're seeing on the ground.
That is NewsHour's Robbie Chavez reporting for us from New Orleans. Robbie, thank you so much. Good to see you.
Thank you.
So how does a musical artist develop a unique style? Well, there's talent and hard work, and also inspiration. At the age of 26, guitarist Yasmin Williams is combining those key ingredients to create a sound all her own. Special correspondent Tom Cachado has this story for us for our arts and culture series, Canvas.
At first listen, Yasmin Williams might seem just another great acoustic guitar picker. But keep your ears and eyes open, and you'll find that her approach is all her own. From the New York Times to Rolling Stone, from music sites Pitchfork to Paste, she's been hailed as what the Washington Post calls a new kind of guitar hero. Maybe it's the piano-like hammer on the guitar strings, or maybe it's the microphone picking up her tap shoes. Maybe it's the video of her riding a train through Baltimore during a pandemic. Or maybe it's her offhand stage presence.
So like, okay, did that song sound happy or sad to you guys? Happy. Yeah, no, I was like miserable when I wrote it. Like, completely like broken.
Whatever the case, as Yasmin Williams' musical biography shows, you don't become a new kind of guitar hero by following an ordinary path.
In my head, if someone were to look at me, they probably wouldn't expect me to make solo acoustic guitar music.
She was born to Northern Virginia parents who played young Yasmin the sounds of R&B, hip-hop, smooth jazz, and the 70s brand of Washington, D.C. funk called go-go, none of which drove her toward early admiration for the acoustic guitar.
I thought it was the lamest instrument. I thought it was super corny. I thought singer-songwriters played it, and they played four chords and sang about their dog or whatever, and that was it. I didn't really think it could do anything substantial.
But beyond that, she had no models for the kind of solo acoustic guitar music she's now known for, a genre so often represented by white male players.
I definitely still wish that I had someone to look up to who was doing what I'm doing now, just to kind of be a guiding light. I mean, someone I can point to and be like, you know, that's really cool, I can do that.
As for guitar music, her first love was heavy metal, first encountered in, well, the video game Guitar Hero.
Guitar Hero is an experience. So you have a guitar-shaped controller, and it has five buttons that are different colors. And you have to push the corresponding, like, colored button that shows up on the screen.
Like this fellow does in this YouTube
red,
demo.
Red, yellow, blue tap. Red, yellow, blue tap. Orange tap.
You had to tap really quickly, and I got good at that, and I beat the game. Once I got my real guitar, I wanted to, like, transfer the tapping skills onto a real guitar, and that's obviously a big part of my playing.
Tapping on the guitar neck is just one of the percussive elements she employs to create a unique style.
So for those who don't know, this is called a kalimba. And do y'all know Earth, Wind, and Fire?
You've mentioned Earth, Wind, and Fire as an influence.
Yes, they are my favorite band. I first heard a kalimba from them. Maurice White played a very long kalimba solo, and I was a kid. I had maybe 4 or 5. And I remember hearing like the tone of his kalimba and just wondering, like, what is that? It's not a saxophone, it's not a guitar, it's not drums, what is that?
The kalimba is a Southern African instrument with a wooden soundboard and steel keys. It's an unlikely accessory taped to the body of an acoustic guitar. But it makes sense once she's explained it. Others of her inspirations are a bit harder to explain. One is Jimi Hendrix, you know him. The other is the godfather of go-go, Chuck Brown. What do sounds like this have to do with her music?
Jimi Hendrix and Chuck Brown.
Yeah.
Hard to hear that.
Yeah. Yeah, you're not really gonna hear much Chuck Brown. You're not gonna hear many go-go beats in my music. But I mean more, I'm influenced by how a musician carries themselves or expresses themselves in their music. For example, Chuck Brown, a go-go legend, is an influence on me because he basically changed the musical landscape of an entire region, Washington, D.C., by himself. The same thing with Jimi Hendrix. He played the guitar masterfully. No one knew what he was doing. No one knew how he was doing it. He didn't really care what critics had to say in terms of him playing quote-unquote wrong. He played what he wanted to play.
Yasmin Williams makes music without lyrics, but not without meaning. Her latest album is called Urban Driftwood.
Urban, meaning me. I come from an urban background. My family comes from an urban background. And that's really important to me. Driftwood, I feel like the Black community is kind of treated like driftwood as such. Lots of people love our culture and love what we do, but they don't particularly treat us with the respect that we deserve a lot of the time, considering how significant our influence has been for centuries. And driftwood is a lot of the time seen as trash or something that is not really needed, even though it houses tons of marine life. It's very beautiful.
You say that when you were young, you didn't see somebody who looked like you playing solo acoustic guitar. Do you ever think about how somebody now who's a kid is going to see Yasmin Williams and say, she looks like me?
Oh, that's enough to make me cry. I mean, I hope that happens. That'll be incredible. That's just like,
you know, people are now watching.
Give me a second. I'm actually crying.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Tom Cachotto.
And on the NewsHour online, amid a rise in hate crimes targeting Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders, a new generation of activists is raising awareness and calling for more resources to stop the violence. You can read more at pbs.org/newshour. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Amna Nawaz. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening with analysis of the week's news with David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you for joining us. We'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
The landscape has changed, and not for the last time. The rules of business are being reinvented with a more flexible workforce, by embracing innovation, by looking not only at current opportunities, but ahead to future ones. Resilience is the ability to pivot again and again for whatever happens next.
People who know BDO.
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular has been offering no-contract wireless plans designed to help people do more of what they like. Our U.S.-based customer service team can help find a plan that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.